Tanzania, nduku ya Uganda.
Hello, welcome to the New Vision History Podcast.
On April 23rd, 1979, Idi Amin, the third president of the Republic of Uganda, left for exile aboard a Russian C-130 plane, bringing to an end his regime that had been characterized by brutality and extrajudicial killings. Today we bring you the story of Amin's final journey out of Uganda.
On behalf of the Uganda National Liberation Front, we have today, Wednesday 11th April 1979, captured the Ugandan capital of Kampala. From today, the racist, fascist and illegal regime of dictator Idi Amin is no longer in power.
Starting October 1978 up to March 1979, a combination of the Tanzanian army and Ugandan exilees fought Amin's troops with the aim of overthrowing him, but progress at the front line was slow. However, on March 10th and 11th, 1979, things took the wrong turn for Amin after the Tanzanian army overpowered his troops at the Battle of Lukaya, 106 kilometers southwest of Kampala, Uganda's capital city. Senior officers who took part in the fighting said whatever could go wrong on that day went wrong for President Idi Amin at the time. First was the death of the battle commander, Colonel Godwin Sule, who was reportedly run over by his own APC before the main fighting began. With the collapsed command and a combination of ill-trained Uganda army soldiers and 2,000 Libyan troops who were not familiar to fighting in a tropical terrain, Amin's forces were overrun by Tanzanians, who mostly deployed the lethal and devastating BM-21 Grad multiple rocket launcher that was locally known as Saba Saba. The fall of Amin's capital city became imminent. The Tanzanian side, on the other hand, had clear-headed commanders such as David Musuguri, Imran Kombe, Mwita Marwa, Tito Okello Lutua, and David Oyire Ojok. The Western Axis stretching from Isinjiro through Ankole, FRONASA's Yoweri Museveni had also stretched the Amin army. With a heavy loss of about 400 soldiers and good commanders such as Lieutenant Godwin Sule at the Battle of Lukaya, the fall of the Amin regime was now imminent. It was after this defeat that Amin's army officers in Kampala, like Isaac Mariamungu and Yusuf Gowon, started loading their belongings and families onto army trucks and driving them northwards to their villages, mostly West Nile, fearing what would befall them with the imminent downfall of the regime. As senior officers moved their families to safety, Amin still had hope of repelling the invading forces. He was busy at his Cape Town villa in Munyonyo on the shores of Lake Victoria, drawing battle plans on how to defend Kampala as Tanzanians and Ugandan National Liberation Forces made rapid advance towards the capital. As the battle raged on, Amin, who had vowed not to leave Kampala, started preparing his family for a flight to exile towards the end of March 1979. This exercise was not easy because about five of Amin's children were at Kabale Preparatory School that was located behind the enemy lines in southwestern Kabale district. In a desperate move, he sent a group of soldiers to maneuver through the enemy territory and pick his children from Kabale and bring them to Kampala. When the children arrived in Kampala, they were reunited with their other sibling and hurriedly put on a cargo plane that used to fly out Ugandan coffee and taken to Libya in the middle of the night. But the flight was not easy. Electricity at the airport had been switched off because the Tanzanian army was in the vicinity and had started shelling the airport area. Vehicles were lined up to light the runway and guide the plane to take off. Although the pilot insisted he was tired, he was persuaded and paid big sums of dollars to fly the president's family out of danger. Meanwhile, in Kampala, Amin was busy holding meetings with remnant senior officers in an effort to save the downfall of his regime. Realizing that Tanzania's capture of Kampala was a matter of hours and not days, Amin moved to Cape Town Villa in Munyonyo on the shores of Lake Victoria. According to his son Jaffa, at Cape Town Villa, army officers started to persuade his father to leave, and he finally gave in. His convoy of several cars set off for eastern Uganda by road starting from Cape Town Villa in Munyonyo through Chibuli to Shell Jinja Road before finally joining Jinja Road. He chose Jinja Road because it was the safest route. President Julius Nyerere of Tanzania had officially communicated to the Libyan leader Colonel Muammar Gaddafi that Libyan soldiers who were fighting alongside Amin's forces should use Jinja Road as their escape route because it was safest. Amin took advantage of the same route on his way to exile. Amin started on his exile journey dressed in his beloved Air Force military uniform and equipped himself with a machine pistol, which the leader of Palestinian Liberation Organization, Yasser Arafat, had gifted him during his 1975 wedding. Amin had nicknamed the pistol Chialani, meaning sewing machine. He fled in a two-door Benz 28 OCE, whose bonnet and top were painted black. Amin had a stopover in Lugazi, where he addressed the public. He told them he was headed to Gaddafi barracks in Jinja to obtain superior weapons that would repulse the invading Tanzanians. He claimed that the weapons in Jinja were more sophisticated than those in Simba barracks in Barara. From Lugazi, he had another stopover in Mabira Forest, where he camped for the night. Amin spent the whole night crisscrossing the main road. He couldn't sleep that night because of his agony. He was losing state power. On the following morning, he traveled towards Njeru, but branched off at the road leading to Kayunga near Wakisi. Amin disembarked from the car, climbed the hill and observed the Owen Falls Dam in Jinja using binoculars. Upon reaching Owen Falls Dam, he found Lieutenant Colonel Juma Butabika, who was in a jeep mounted with a 106mm recoiler gun. During his stay in Jinja, Amin monitored the situation. He camped in the house which was formerly of Madvani. By then, Amin was still hopeful that the Kenyan government, headed by Daniel Arap Moi, would permit the transit of his weapons, which Gaddafi had shipped through Port Mombasa. Amin had dispatched his minister, Ismail Sebi, to oversee the transportation of these arms and fuel to Uganda. The fuel was shipped to Nairobi by Italian oil company Agip. Amin was also hopeful that the governments of Iran would provide him with ammunition. At the time, the Moroccan government had disregarded his requests. During Amin's stay in Jinja, a Tanzanian fighter jet dropped some bombs that damaged the Libyan Arab Bank building. He walked around in protest and later boarded his vehicle and continued with his escape until he arrived at his three-roomed village home in Tanganyika Parish, Dadamu Sub-County of Arua. While there, Amin had a meeting with his Minister for Education, Brigadier Barnabas Kili, and a few security chiefs. At the end of that meeting in Arua on April 23rd, Amin named Kili as the acting president of Uganda. By this time, the invading forces had named Yusuf Lule as the acting president. After naming Kili, Amin boarded a Russian C-130 plane in Arua and left for Iraq. On board were his wife, Zamzam Nabidi, and a Russian military officer, among others. On arrival in Baghdad in Iraq, his pregnant wife, Nabidi, was admitted in the same hospital with his other wife, Mariam Najemba, who was undergoing a cataract surgery. Amin left them in Iraq and continued to Syria, where the plane was refueled. He was then flown to Benghazi in Libya. Shortly afterwards, Amin traveled to Medina in Tripoli and reunited with his 35 children and wife Sarah Cholava, who had flown from Uganda during the course of the war in March. Towards the end of 1979, Gaddafi relocated Amin and his family from Tripoli to Medina al-Koms, an isolated area in Makoub district along the highway to the Tunisian border. Amin was angered and therefore decided to relocate to Saudi Arabia, where he lived until his death on August 16, 2003.